Despite its modest size, the developer Falcom consistently releases some of the best games I've had the pleasure of playing. While Kiseki will always be the first game that comes to mind when I think of Falcom, Yi's is a very close second. I still fondly remember my first moments in Yi's 8 and how it captivated me with its gameplay, forever making me a fan. Now 4 years later, the next installment, Yi's 9 Monstrum Nox, has been released in the West, and I'm once again able to join Adol on his new exciting adventure. This unlucky guy once again manages to get himself into more trouble, but this time in the prison city of Balduq, where he becomes trapped due to the Monstrum curse inflicted upon him. He must find a way to break the curse, lest he wants to give up his adventuring days for good. Like most Yi's games before it, Yi's 9's story is pretty self-contained, so it's not the worst game to start off on. The only thing to keep in mind would be that there are some references made about Adol's previous exploits that would be lost on new players, but not longtime fans. As someone who still needs to go back and play some of the older games, I experienced a bit of both worlds. The references I missed didn't keep me from enjoying the story or prevent me from following along. Those I did recognize added a nice nostalgic moment to the game, such as seeing the return of my mortal enemy from Yi's origin, the giant centipede boss. I hated that thing with a passion, but it was cool to see it reintroduced in the same familiar way. References aside, the story is captivating and one I consider to be the best yet. Getting cursed inside of a prison city and having it actually be treated as a literal prison seemed too good to just be a coincidence. Something foul appeared to be afoot. Other unusual things like the incarceration of innocent people and the prison having an area that was even restricted from the guards further piqued my curiosity. Every new chapter revealed new twists and mysteries that kept me hooked until the very end. The interesting cast of characters also drew me into the story. Adol eventually meets others like him who are afflicted with the same Monstrum curse. They each have different views of their situation, with some embracing it while others want their normal life back. Their various stances made it less clear if the curse was really a bad thing or a blessing in disguise. The characters were also designed well, which added depth to their decisions and made it feel more meaningful. They had memorable backstories, relatable struggles, and interesting personalities that shaped them into being believable characters. The support cast was also done well. It's always a nice surprise to encounter side characters that are worth investing in, since more often than not, they get ignored. While they aren't explored as in-depth as the main characters, all the important aspects that make a character compelling were still touched on. They had their own unique challenges to overcome, as well as special circumstances that led them to get involved in the events surrounding Balduq. Shantae was a personal favorite who fit all these criteria and had a great personality to boot. He's very flamboyant and gives off a very uplifting vibe, which I don't find in many characters. His past struggles shaped his character, and it was rewarding to see his growth as he became a trusted ally for Adol. As more people joined, the group dynamic became even more lively, creating a very welcoming environment that felt like a home away from home. While the narrative and its characters were appealing, the setting does cause the gameplay to feel slightly more restrictive than the previous games. Being trapped inside Balduq for a majority of the game left few opportunities to see the outside world, causing it to feel less like an adventure. There were a few grasslands and mountains that would eventually open up, but most of the exploration was done in ruins rather than natural environments. On the bright side, dungeons were unique enough where it never felt repetitive, even in the few instances where similar assets, textures, and layouts were used. It also helped that exploration was very engaging through the use of the new gift mechanic, which gives each character a special ability. For instance, using White Cat's gift to walk up walls allowed me to reach a treasure chest that would have been otherwise unattainable. Or I can use Doll's gift to reveal hidden switches that open up new paths. Each level had many intricate layouts that utilized these skills to keep each experience feeling unique. Dungeons saw the biggest benefit from gifts, but they also helped ease the confining feeling of being stuck in a city. It felt satisfying being able to take unusual paths when exploring Balduq rather than just mundanely walking around. They were also needed for reaching some collectibles like graffiti and azure petals scattered across the city, which not only made them fun to use, but useful too. In addition to creating versatile exploration mechanics, gifts further enhanced the combat gameplay. Adol's Crimson Line can be used as a gap closer, which supports the fast-paced action really well, and the Raging Bull's Valkyrie Hammer can break through any kind of guard, giving more offensive options to open up enemies with. There are even boss fights that make use of these gifts as part of their mechanics. While gifts did elevate the combat, what really made it a blast was the new hardest difficulty, Lunatic. It made the skill ceiling even higher, forcing me to learn about the game on a deeper level. As a result, it did take me longer to complete, but I was able to appreciate how important each combat mechanic was. Flash Guard and Flash Move are familiar personal favorites that have been in a couple of the previous games. Flash Guard triggers when a move is blocked at the exact moment an attack lands that grants critical hits and invincibility. Likewise, Flash Move triggers when dodging a move at the last second, but will give increased movement speed and invincibility instead. Trying to master these two moves was difficult with their precise timing, but they were crucial since enemies can easily destroy characters. Once I became more comfortable with their usage, that's when the real fun began as I stacked and refreshed the buffs on the same attack, leading to some pretty crazy damage. Boost is another returning mechanic that added a lot of fun to combat and saved my butt plenty of times. It's built up during combat by attacking enemies and can be triggered once the bar is at least half filled. Boost gives extra firepower, movement speed, and defensive buffs, but most importantly, a character's extra skill can be unleashed, which deals a decent amount of damage. All these mechanics came together to create a thrilling, fast-paced combat system that was incredibly enjoyable. Lunatic difficulty also gave me further appreciation for other aspects of gameplay I frequently take for granted. Finding consumables gave useful items that got me through tough boss fights, so it didn't feel like just busy work with no payoff. Progression was also more important than ever, as using the best available equipment made it easier to kill enemies while living through one more attack. This also meant that I had to manage my resources efficiently, as there wasn't enough to fully gear everyone. Being able to trade bulks of low-level materials for high-level ones did make progression feel more feasible, though. Materials were also used for relics, which are tools for the mandatory minigame Grindwald Nox, Purge and Siege. This is the same interception and suppression minigame from Yi's 8 that I really liked, so I'm glad to see it come back. The goal is to protect or destroy crystals, and relics were extremely helpful in making things more manageable by providing distractions and extra defenses. It was especially fun with how chaotic it could get with the swarms of enemies attacking from every angle. Purges and sieges were rewarding to do too, since they gave a bunch of useful items for completing them with the highest ranking. With the superb gameplay and interesting story, Yi's 9 is shaping up as a game to be remembered. But there is one more crucial element that really brings it all home. That's the music. There are some fantastic tracks in this OST that fit any situation that may arise. They bring out the extra emotion in story scenes, whether it's with a hopeful soundtrack or a sad, slow-sounding track. The combat music was spot on, adding on to the adrenaline rush and making the fights feel exciting. The music was always there to elevate the game and add to the immersive experience. Yi's 9 gave me everything I hoped for in a Yi's game. The gameplay was incredible, the story was interesting, and the music was phenomenal. It's hard for me to find any major faults. If I was being nitpicky, the graphics could use a bit of an upgrade, but I also know that Falcom doesn't have the resources to focus on this aspect. With a new game engine coming down the line, maybe there will be some noticeable improvements. Regardless, it's always been the story and gameplay that makes their games great. For Yi's 9, it was the lunatic difficulty that really set it apart from other games for me. I had such a blast playing through it, I didn't want it to end. But like all good things, it must. It'll probably be a few years before another Yi's game is even announced, but if Yi's 9 is anything to go by, things will only get better.